Welcome back everyone. My today's lesson is about torch infection in children. So stay with me till the end. I will start my today's lesson with some quiz. So the first quiz is, which torch infection presents with A. Snaffles, B. Blueberry muffin lesion, C. Prevent ventricular calcification, and the last one is, which will prevent with no symptoms, or which one can be asymptomatic at all. And the second question is, which torch infection can be absolutely be prevented? So we'll answer those questions after discussing about each torch infection. To start as an introduction, torch is an acronym for a group of congenitally acquired infections that may cause significant morbidity and mortality in neonates. Torch stands for the following acronym. T stands for toxoplasmosis, O stands for others, mainly syphilis, R stands for rubella, C stands for cytomegalovirus, and H stands for herpes simplex virus. When do we think of torch infection in newborns? So, which one is an entry point for thinking about torch infection in the newborn? So, the main entry point, or when we should have to think of torch infection, is one, when the newborn is IGR, or intrauterine growth retardation. The other is if a newborn have hepatosplenomegaly, unexplained thrombocytopenia, unusual rash, concerning maternal history. That means if there is any sign and symptoms of each torch infections during pregnancy, we should have to think of torch infection in a newborn. The other is a classic finding of any specific infection. If a newborn have classic, for example, blueberry muffin, classic snaffles, and other things, periventricular calcification, and the like. So if there is a classic finding of any specific infection, we should have to think of torch infection. When a congenital infection is suspected, a rough maternal history should be obtained, including immunization status, past and recent infection, and exposure. A carefully taken physical examination of the neonate is vital because different clinical findings may indicate a specific diagnosis. Diagnostic testing should be directed only toward those infections that fit the clinical and historical picture. The sometimes employed torch titers should never be used as a single test to diagnose or rule out a congenital infection. So we should not forget, torch titers should never be used as a single test to diagnose or rule out a congenital infection. An attempt to diagnose torch infection with a single serum sample, that means torch titer, is useless information. Test for each potential etiology should be done. So we should have to test each. If we suspected cytomegalovirus, we should have to test for it. If we suspected congenital rubella, we should have to test for it specifically. So don't use torch titer as a specific diagnosis. Because the idea of using torch infection comes from, IgM shows new infection, and it's produced in acute or late phase of primary infection and appear immediately after infection, and usually persists till 2 to 3 months, and it might persist for 1 to 2 years. And IgG represents old infection, and it appears 1 to 2 weeks after an infection, and it falls within 1 to 2 months, and it persists for lifelong. When we came to toxoplasmosis, or congenital toxo, congenital toxoplasmosis is a parasitic disease that can cause significant fetal and neonatal harm. It is caused by a protozoa called Toxoplasma gondii. And the domestic cat is the definitive host with infections via, the first one is ingestion of the cyst, either through the garden products or meat, or any contact with host in the feces. And acute infection usually is asymptomatic, and one-third risk of fatal infection with primary maternal infection in pregnancy. So if the mother is infected, the chance of transmitting to the newborn is around 33%. Infection rate is higher if the infection occurs during the third trimester, and fatal death is higher with infection in the first trimester. This means the chance of transmitting toxoplasmosis to the newborn is higher if the infection occurs to the mother during third trimester. While, even though the chance of transmission is lower during the first trimester, if it is transmitted during the first trimester, it has high sequel, high risk of fatal disease, higher than that of the third trimester transmission. So transmission is higher during second trimester, whereas fatal disease is higher during the first trimester transmission. There are three ways that causes congenital toxoplasmosis can occur. The first one is congenital toxoplasmosis can develop through transmission of Toxoplasma gondii to the fetus from a previously seronegative immunocompetent mother who acquired acute primary infection during pregnancy or within 3 months before conception. Whereas the second one is congenital toxoplasmosis can occur through reactivation of toxoplasmosis in a previously toxoplasmosis gondii immune pregnant woman who was severely immunocompromised during pregnancy. And the third one is it can result after reinfection of a previously immune pregnant mother with a new, more virulent strain. For example, after travel or international travel, after eating undercooked meat from areas where more virulent atypical strains predominate. So these are the three mechanisms by which a mother transmits toxoplasmosis to an infant or newborn. More than 70 to 90% are asymptomatic at birth. And there is a classic triad of symptoms that we should never forget about toxoplasmosis. These are chorioretinitis, hydrocephalus, and intracranial calcification. So these are a classic triad of symptoms for a congenital toxoplasmosis. But those are not the only clinical manifestations. These are the classic triads. Other clinical manifestations that can appear in a child who were infected with toxoplasmosis in utero is fever, rash, hepatosplenomegaly, microcephaly, seizure, jaundice, thrombocytopenia, lymphadenopathy, and the like. And even if they are initially asymptomatic infants are still at high risk of developing abnormalities, especially chorioretinitis. So if a baby is asymptomatic at delivery, that does not mean that the child will be okay for lifelong, because there is still a chance of having chorioretinitis which develops later in life. This is a chorioretinitis of congenital toxoplasmosis. Clinical evaluation of infants with suspected congenital toxoplasmosis includes a detailed physical examination, detailed neurologic evaluation, a detailed ophthalmologic examination, preferably by a retinal specialist, and brain stem auditory evoked response is necessary. And imaging evaluation include computer tomography of the head or head sonography and abdominal ultrasound. If CT has not been confirmed but also has not been ruled out, an infant workup include complete clinical evaluation and serial IgG antibody titer every 4 to 6 weeks after birth until complete disappearance of toxoplasma IgG antibodies. So we should have to determine serially, because this IgG can be a maternal one, and if it is maternal one, it is expected to disappear after a few months. But if the titer progressively increased, it shows that there is transmission of congenital toxoplasmosis from the mother to the newborn. So IgG antibody titer is a diagnostic test that we can use for to diagnose congenital toxoplasmosis in the newborn. When we came to prevention and the treatment of congenital toxoplasmosis, since some centers test a mom prenatally, if a mom is diagnosed to have toxoplasmosis prenatally, she should be treated with spiromycin, pyrimethamine, and sulfadiazine. And also leucovorin rescue with pyrimethamine is needed. And if found that the baby is having toxoplasmosis after delivery, if a baby is symptomatic, we'll treat with pyrimethamine with leucovorin rescue and sulfadiazine. The treatment is for 12 months duration. And if a baby is also asymptomatic, there is still a chance of developing chorioretinitis later in life, so we should have to treat asymptomatic infants with toxoplasmosis as that of symptomatic infants. And this is important because improved neurologic and the developmental outcomes demonstrated compared to untreated patients or those treated for only 1 month. When we see specific dose of the drugs, Pyrimethamine is given as 2 mg per kg per day orally, divided twice per day for the first 2 days. Then from day 3 to 2 months or up to 6 months, 1 mg per kg per day orally every day. And after that, 1 mg per kg per day orally 3 times per week for 12 months is needed. Sulfadiazine is given at a dose of 100 mg per kg per day orally, divided twice per day. Leucovorin or folinic acid, 10 mg 3 times per week is needed. This is a dose specific dose for treatment of congenital toxoplasmosis. When we see about congenital syphilis, syphilis is caused by Treponema pallidum, and it is transmitted via sexual contact, and it is also transmitted from the mother to a newborn. And the placental transmission occurs as early as 6 weeks pregnancy, and it typically occurs during the second half of the pregnancy. And a mom with primary or secondary syphilis more likely to transmit than a latent disease. And also large decrease in congenital syphilis since late 1990s globally. Two-thirds of affected live-born infants are asymptomatic at birth. So majority of newborns who are affected by congenital syphilis are asymptomatic at delivery. And clinical symptoms split into early and late. If the more than two-thirds are asymptomatic and only one-third are symptomatic at delivery after birth, and if they are symptomatic, it is classified into two, early and late. Early is if the symptom starts before 2 years of age, and the late is if the symptoms of congenital syphilis starts after 2 years of age. Three major classification: fatal effect, early effect, and late effect. Fatal effect is if the symptoms or if the disease starts in utero, it can cause stillbirths, neonatal death, or hydrops fatalis. And intrauterine disease occur in up to 25% of intrauterinely infected infants. And the perinatal mortality occurs in 25-30% of untreated intrauterinely infected congenital syphilis. Whereas early congenital syphilis occurs in the first 2 years of life, but it typically occurs in the first 5 weeks of life. The cutoff point to define early congenital syphilis is if the symptom starts within 2 years. But majority of early congenital syphilis occurs within the first 5 weeks of life. They are presented with a cutaneous lesion on palms and the soles, hepatosplenomegaly, jaundice, anemia, and snaffles, periostates, and the metaphyseal dystrophy, and also funicides or umbilical cord vasculitis. So snaffles that we raised in the initial as a quiz is a classic symptoms for congenital syphilis. And periostites and metaphyseal dystrophy and also umbilical cord vasculitis, which is called funicides, is a classic lesion for a congenital syphilis. When we came to this is an image of a periostitis of long bones seen in neonatal syphilis, early onset neonatal syphilis, which occurs in the first 2 years of life. When we see the late congenital syphilis, it presented with frontal bossing, short maxilla, high palatal arc, Hutchinson's disease, AIDS nerve deafness, saddle nose, perioral fissures, and it can be prevented with appropriate treatment. So this congenital syphilis, they presented with such symptoms after 2 years of life. This is Hutchinson's disease. It is a late result of congenital syphilis. This is a typical dental sign of syphilis. It is called Hutchinson's disease. When we come to the diagnosis of syphilis, there are many specific tests and a confirmatory test. Non-treponema tests are used. The non-treponema tests or titers are used to detect antibodies that are not specific for Treponema pallidum. They are sensitive, but they are not specific. But the confirmatory or treponema tests are such as Treponema pallidum particle agglutinate test, fluorescent Treponema antibody absorbed test, T pallidium enzyme immunoassay antibody test, and others. They are a group of tests. These tests are based upon the detection of antibodies directed against specific treponemal antigen, and the treponemal tests are qualitative only, and they are reported as reactive and non-reactive. There is of only one type of serology test is insufficient for the diagnosis. So most of the time we use VDRL or venereal disease research laboratory test, and the rapid plasma reagent test as a test to know whether the mother is infected with syphilis or not, but these are non-specific. So if VDRL and RPR are positive, we should have to go to confirmatory test. This is the step required to diagnose congenital syphilis. So positive VDRL means, it doesn't mean it is treponemal pallidum. It's non-specific. Other non-treponemal causes can cause such test positive. But if this VDRL is positive, you should have to go to confirmatory test to test whether it is treponemal pallidum or not. As we have said, the available serologic tests are RPR and the VDRL. These are non-treponemal tests and they are sensitive, but they are not specific. Quantitative, so can follow to determine disease activity and the treatment response. The importance is when we the importance of doing VDRL is, since they are quantitative, we can follow with it. If the number is decreasing, if the quantitative number is decreasing, that means that after treatment, the patient is improving. If it is increasing, the patient is not improving or it's worsening. They are sensitive and also they are not specific. The specific treponemal test or confirmatory tests are used for confirmatory testing and qualitative, and they are qualitative and they only say positive or negative, and they are not used to follow a drug for to follow disease activity, because if they say positive ones, they are positive lifelong, so we don't know whether the patient is improving or deteriorating. We don't know whether the patient is responding to our treatment or not by a confirmatory test, because it only shows positive and the negative, but the non-treponemal test or VDRL test shows number. So if the number is decreasing by VDRL test, the patient is responding to our treatment. So the confirmatory test screen in ALL pregnant women early in pregnancy and at time of birth. And this is early, this is easily treated, and we should have to do it in all pregnancy. So in our setup, VDRL is done for all pregnant women who comes for antenatal care follow-up. If we found a child after delivery, we can diagnose congenital syphilis by examining a blood of a child, a CSF of a child, and also a skin lesion of the newborn. Serologic testing of mother and the child for VDRL and the dark field examination of skin lesion on the newborn and sometimes of placenta and umbilical cord samples may help diagnose early congenital syphilis. According to CDC definition of congenital syphilis, we say it is confirmed if treponema pallidum identified in skin lesion, placenta, umbilical cord, or at autopsy. So we say it is confirmatory syphilis if we identify treponema pallidum on a skin lesion, on a placenta, on umbilical cord, or at autopsy. And the presumptive diagnosis if physical examination finding is suggestive of syphilis, or if CSF finding is positive for VDRL, or if ostats on long bones x-rays seen, and if barbershop pole or umbilical cord or funisat that we have said is seen, and if VDRL is greater than 4 times maternal test, or if a positive IgM antibody is seen after delivery, we can make a presumptive diagnosis of congenital syphilis. When we came to the diagnosis of congenital syphilis, penicillin G is the drug of choice for all syphilis infection, and the maternal treatment during pregnancy is very effective. And if we treat a mother during pregnancy before 4 weeks of delivery, the overall effect success of treatment is 98%. And treat newborn if they meet CDC diagnostic criteria, mom was treated less than 4 weeks before delivery, if a mom was treated with a non-penicillin drug, and if maternal titers do not show adequate response and less than fourfold decline. Now this is overall guideline of treatment of congenital syphilis. If in infants with proven or highly probable diagnosis of congenital syphilis, including abnormal physical examination or laboratory or radiologic results indicative of congenital syphilis, or if the serum quantitative non-treponemal titer is greater than or equal to fourfold of that of the maternal titer, or if a positive microscopic examination of the treponema pallidum is made, we should have to treat with either aqueous penicillin for 10 days or with procaine penicillin for 10 days. Infants with a normal physical examination and the serum non-treponemal titer less than fourfold of that of the maternal titer, whose mother received inadequate treatment,
we should have to give procaine penicillin 14 days or crystalline penicillin 14 days, or a single dose of benzantin penicillin can be given. Infants with a normal physical examination, the serum and troponemal titer less than fourfold of that of the maternal titer, whose mother received adequate treatment, should take a single dose of benzantin penicillin. If a mother is treated appropriately during pregnancy, and if a newborn has no sign of physical examination for a congenital syphilis, we should have to only give a single dose of benzantin penicillin IM. And infants with a normal physical examination and serum and troponemal titer less than fourfold the maternal titer, whose mothers received adequate treatment and whose titers were serofast prior to delivery, non-treatment is required. When we come to congenital rubella infection, infection with rubella virus causes the most severe damage when the mother is infected early in pregnancy, especially during the first 12 weeks of pregnancy or during the first trimester of pregnancy. Rubella is a single-stranded RNA virus that is a vaccine-preventable disease, and it's mild and self-limiting illness, and infection early in pregnancy has higher probability of affected infants. So if the mother is infected during the first trimester of pregnancy, it has higher probability of transmission to the child. So this is a vaccine preventable disease. On the initial question, I have asked which of the torch infection is vaccine preventable, which can be completely prevented. From this, rubella is one. Rubella is a completely vaccine preventable disease. Congenital rubella syndrome is a condition that occurs in the developing baby in the womb whose mother is infected with the rubella virus. Pregnant women who contract rubella at risk for miscarriage or stillbirth, and their developing babies are at risk for severe birth defect with devastating lifelong consequences. Congenital rubella syndrome can affect almost everything in the developing baby's body. The most common birth defects from congenital rubella syndrome can include deafness, cataract, heart defect, intellectual disability, liver and spleen damage, low birth weight, skin rash at birth, and less common complications from congenital rubella syndrome can include glaucoma, brain damage, thyroid and other hormone problems, and inflammation of the lungs and the like. But the most common ones are sensory neural healing loss, which occurs in 50-75% of children, cataracts and the glaucoma, which can occur in 20-50%, and the cardiac malformation, mainly PDA, which occurs in 20-50%. PDA is the most common criteria for congenital rubella syndrome, but other cardiac malformation can happen. Neurologic manifestation can occur in 10-20%, and others, to include growth retardation, bone disease, hepatosplenomegaly, and thrombocytopenia, can occur. Blueberry muffin is a classic lesion. Even though it occurs in other diseases, blueberry muffin is a classic lesion for congenital rubella. I have also asked it as a quiz as the initial. So this is a blueberry muffin on the skin of a child with a congenital rubella. Blueberry muffin occurs. It is a spot representing extramedullary hematopoiesis. This is due to a hematopoiesis which is at extramedullary site. So don't forget, if you are to remember that blueberry muffin happens due to extramedullary hematopoiesis. When we came to diagnosing congenital rubella syndrome, maternal IgG may represent immunization or past infection. So it is useless, because some countries immunize a mother for rubella because it is a vaccine preventable disease, and if a mother is vaccinated, she can be positive for IgG. So it is useless. The most important thing is to isolate a virus from either nasal secretion or from blood, urine, or CSF. So this one is isolating a virus from the nasal secretion, from the throat, from the blood, and from the urine or CSF is the best diagnostic method to diagnose congenital rubella syndrome if the child has signed the symptoms of congenital rubella syndrome. Serologic testing, IgM may show recent postnatal or congenital infection, and the rising monthly IgG titer suggests a congenital infection. So we can either isolate a virus from the nasal secretion or from the blood or urine or from the CSF of a newborn, or we can follow monthly IgG titers, and if it is increasing or raising monthly IgG titers of the newborn suggests congenital infection. This is how we can diagnose congenital rubella syndrome. Diagnosing after 1 year of age is difficult to establish because IgM can be due to postnatal infection or rising IgG can also be after 1 year of age. It can be due to a congenital or it can be due to acquired infection. When we came to treatment of congenital rubella syndrome, all those specific symptoms can be treated. There is no cure for congenital rubella syndrome. Since there is no cure, it is important for a woman to get vaccinated before they get pregnant. So after congenital rubella syndrome, the only treatment is supportive. So the important thing is prevention by vaccinating a pregnant woman before pregnancy. When we come to vaccine recommendation, women who are planning to become pregnant should check with their physician to make sure they are vaccinated before they get pregnant. Because MMR vaccine is attenuated or weakened live virus vaccine, pregnant women who are not vaccinated should wait to get MMR vaccine until after they have given birth. Adult women of childbearing age should avoid getting pregnant for at least 4 weeks after receiving MMR vaccine. And a pregnant woman should not get MMR vaccine because it is a attenuated live virus vaccine. When we came to congenital CMV infection, CMV infection it is the most common congenital viral infection. From all congenital viral infections, CMV is the most common one. Congenital cytomegalovirus infection it's a mild and self-limiting illness, and the transmission can occur with primary infection or it can be due to reactivation of the virus, and the 40% of risk of transmission in a primary infection. And studies suggest that increased risk of transmission later in pregnancy can occur, however, more severe sequelae associated with earlier acquisition. So, more severe sequelae is occur when there is earlier acquisition of the disease. When we see congenital CMV infection, 90% of a newborn who have congenital cytomegalovirus infections are asymptomatic at birth. Only up to 50%, 10 to 50% develop symptoms later. That means they develop since the neural hearing loss. So 10% are symptomatic at birth, 90% are asymptomatic at birth. From 90% that are asymptomatic at birth, 50% of them will develop sensory neural hearing loss later in life. And only 10% are symptomatic. From the symptomatic infections, the most common symptoms are small for gestational age, hepatosplenomegaly, petechia, jaundice, chorioretinitis, and periventricular calcification, neurologic deficits, and the greater than 80% develop long-term complications such as hearing loss, vision impairment, and the developmental delay. So, if a child have congenital CMV infection, 10% are symptomatic at birth with these clinical symptoms, and 90% are asymptomatic at birth. From the 90% that are asymptomatic at birth, 15% will develop sensory neural hearing loss later. And periventricular calcification is diagnostic importance in CMV infection. When we see intracranial calcification of toxoplasmosis and the intracranial calcifications of CMV intracranial calcification is periventricular, whereas that of toxoplasmosis is diffuse calcification in the brain. So we should have to remember this. If we are asked to respond to what causes periventricular calcification from torch infection, we should not forget CMV. And if it is diffuse calcification, it is toxoplasmosis. So this is the main difference of intracranial calcifications of CMV and the toxoplasmosis. This is periventricular calcification of a child with congenital CMV infection. And also there is ventriculomegaly and periventricular calcification of congenital CMV. So as we have seen in this image, there is a periventricular calcification with a big ventricles. Ventriculomegaly with periventricular calcification of CMV infection. Whereas in a toxoplasmosis, the intracranial calcification is diffuse. It's not periventricular. When congenital CMV infection is diagnosed by detection of CMV DNA in the urine and also saliva, and the saliva is preferred most of the time, or we can also detect CMV DNA in blood within 3 weeks after birth. Infection cannot be diagnosed using tests that detect antibodies to CMV. And congenital CMV infection cannot be diagnosed using samples collected more than 3 weeks after birth, because testing after this time cannot distinguish between congenital infection and infection acquired during or after delivery. So, congenital CMV infection cannot be diagnosed after 3 weeks of birth, because it can be postnatal, post-delivery infection. Maternal IgG shows only past infection, and infection can is common worldwide, and this is useless. And always the most important thing that we should have to do to diagnose congenital CMV infection is viral isolation from urine or saliva in the first 3 weeks of life. Viral load and the DNA copies can be assessed by PCR, and less useful for diagnosis, but it helps in following viral activity in a patient. And serologies are not helpful given high antibody in the pupil. When we came to the treatment of congenital CMV infection, for infants with signs of congenital CMV disease at birth, antiviral medication such as ganciclovir or valganciclovir may improve hearing and the developmental outcomes. Ganciclovir can have serious side effects and has only been studied in infants with symptomatic congenital CMV infection. So we give ganciclovir for congenital CMV infection which are symptomatic. And there is limited information on the effectiveness of ganciclovir or valganciclovir to treat infants with hearing loss alone. An infant diagnosed with congenital CMV infection should have regular hearing and vision test, and most infants with congenital CMV grow up healthy. And early detection and intervention for children with hearing and vision problem may improve outcomes. So we should have to follow hearing screening every 6 months, earlier if possible. When we came to another toxic infection, that is herpes simplex virus infection, it can be caused by herpes simplex virus 1 or herpes simplex virus 2. The incidence of neonatal herpes simplex virus infection is estimated to range between 1 in 3,000 to 1 in 20,000 live births, and herpes simplex virus is transmitted to a neonate most commonly during birth through an infected maternal genital tract, but can be caused by ascending infection through ruptured or intact amniotic membranes. Other less common sources of neonatal infection include postnatal transmission from a parent or other caregiver, most often from a non-genital lesion, for example, on the mouth or hands. The risk of herpes simplex virus transmission to a neonate born to a mother who acquires primary congenital infection near the time of delivery is estimated to be 25 to 60%. In contrast, the risk to a neonate born to mother shedding herpes simplex virus as a result of reactivation of infection acquired during the first half of pregnancy or early is less than 2%. So primarily, it is transmitted through infected maternal genital tract, and the rationale for cesarean section delivery prior to membrane rupture is to prevent transmission of herpes simplex virus to the newborn, and the primary infection with greater transmission risk than when we came to the clinical manifestations of a congenital herpes simplex virus infection. Herpes simplex virus infection in newborns infants can show up as the following three patterns of equal frequency with symptoms between birth to 4 weeks of age. The first one is disseminated disease involving multiple organs, most prominently liver and the lung, and the second one is localized CNS disease with or without skin involvement. This is around 30%, and this is limited to skin, eyes and the mouth, or SEM disease. This accounts around 45%. So skin, eye and the mouth involvement is responsible for around 45%, whereas the second one is localized CNS infection, which is responsible for 30%, and 25% is disseminated disease. More than 80% of neonates with skin, eye and the mouth disease have skin vesicles. Those patients without skin vesicles have infection limited to the eyes and oral mucosa. Disseminated infection is consideration when neonate present with sepsis syndrome, negative bacteriologic culture result, and severe liver dysfunction or consumptive coagulopathy. So we should not forget to think of disseminated herpes simplex virus infection if a neonate presents with the signs and symptoms of sepsis plus negative bacteriologic culture plus severe liver derangement plus consumptive coagulopathy. Initial manifestations vary and specific with skin lesion not necessarily present. So some expect skin lesion to be present to say congenital herpes simplex virus. So this is wrong and the skin lesion may not be present in most children with congenital herpes simplex virus infection. This is signs of congenital herpes simplex virus infection. There is a diffuse skin lesion. To diagnose congenital herpes simplex virus infection, culture of maternal lesion if present at delivery and culture in infants of skin lesion or oropharynx, eyes, urine, blood, rectum or CSF can be done. So isolation of the virus by culture in infant's skin lesion or in the infant's body secretion or urine or CSF is important. And also CSF PCR can diagnose congenital herpes simplex virus infection. And the serology is again not helpful given high prevalence of herpes simplex virus antibody in population. When we came to treatment, high dose of acyclovir, 60 mg per kg per day in 3 divided dose, that means 20 mg per kg per dose TID for 21 days is given for a disseminated and CNS disease, and it can be given for 14 days for skin, eye and mouth disease. And ocular involvement requires topical therapy as well. So when we came to answer to a quiz that we saw initially, snaphylis, a sign of syphilis, chorioretinitis, hydrocephalus and intracranial calcification is a sign of toxoplasmosis, blueberry muffin is a sign of rubella, and periventricular calcification is a sign of CMV infection, and no symptom is all of them. So all of them can present with asymptomatic adverse. And which torch infection can absolutely be prevented? Rubella and syphilis. Don't forget, rubella and syphilis are a preventable disease. If a mother have appropriate immunization and if appropriate ANDC is done, antenatal follow-up and screening for VDRL and the treatment of syphilis during pregnancy. So syphilis and rubella is preventable disease. The rubella is vaccine preventable disease, whereas syphilis can be diagnosed during pregnancy and if a mother is treated, the chance of transmission to a new baby is prevented more than 98%. So thank you for your attention. Please don't forget to subscribe this channel.